Good morning. Are you ready to worship Jesus? I have a few announcements for you. I want you to remember every single day at 12 o'clock to take 12 minutes out to pray. We're praying for our neighbors. Let God lay someone on your heart that He wants you to help win. We're praying for our church, and we're praying for the leaders both locally and nationally, and I would say globally. Also, we have a community yard sale coming up May 22nd, and Bob Beckner's going to be in charge, and the proceeds from our little part of that are going to help buy some equipment that we need for the online campus. So if you've got things to donate, talk to Bob Beckner, and he can help you know what we need done when. And it's May 22nd, which I think is this Saturday, this coming Saturday. So if you've got something, talk to him today. Also, next week, we have a missionary, Dan Johnson, that's going to be here. And that's always so exciting because we get to hear what's going on. He's a missionary in Spain, and we can partner with him. We can't all go, but we can all go with praying and giving and supporting missionaries who do go. This morning we're going to look at a scripture, and it's Psalms 122:6, and it says, "Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they be secure who love you." And this is a time in our world where we need to be in prayer. And as a church, we need to be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. We need to be praying for God's outpouring here. And we need to be asking God to just move. So let's bow our heads, and we're going to go into a time of worship, and we're going to open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that we can lift up Jerusalem and that we can unite with them and pray according to your word for peace in Jerusalem. We also pray that your spirit will work here in our church, our community, our country, and out into the world, Lord. There's a lot of people who don't know you, and give us a burden for them. Help us to want to reach them, because we have the good news. We have an exciting God who is alive, who walks with us every day. Help us to carry that mantle to share with others. And we just thank you. And as we worship you today, we just invite your presence in. And we thank you for all the wonderful things you do for us, that you are with us. And we just ask you to accept our worship and praise. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing back to grace when the darkness comes.
You are good, good, oh.
sick face, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to breathe something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. Jesus, I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, but it's all about you, all about you, Jesus, King of endless worth. No one could express how much you deserve. It's not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing all about you, Jesus. When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to breathe something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. Bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
And your mercy. Father God, we come to you this morning to ask that you would have your way, that you would speak to our hearts, our lives, that you use us for your benefit, that we would honor you in all that we say and all that we do, that you would be our focus, that we would walk towards you. Jesus, we need you. Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. So as you are seated, if you are a kid, you can stand up. All right, head for Children's Church. Mark, set, go. Woo-hoo! Love it. Yeah, come on. Age has nothing to do with it. You could be 90 and be excited like that. Just can't run. Well, maybe you can. I was this last week, actually it was yesterday, I went with my babies, so Emmett and Rhema, we walked to the mailbox, and Rhema held my hand, and Emmett stayed away, because he's eight, and cool, boys that are eight don't hold their dad's hands. They were moving along, and in the midst of all this, Emmett noticed something that was kind of interesting. They were all walking in the same pattern. He says, Dad, look, I'm ahead of you, Rhema's next to you, but we're all taking the same steps. And I'm like, whoa, that's interesting, right? But it's crazy. If you look at my kids, you take Emmett, and he's just kind of all over the place, right? And Rhema and I were just walking along, and I feel like I'm just walking straight, but we all walk differently. But what's crazy about it is we had the same pace. You ever take a moment to just watch people in the mall or out and about? Are you that person? Yes, you're creepy. No, I'm just kidding. I do the same thing, but I love to watch people walk. And as a kid, I had different walks. Of course, you know that that I've told stories about track and being able to stay in my lane, that I wasn't very good at that. And I would kind of use the lane as a whole. And Debbie, my wife, would say that I still drive like I run. I use the whole road. I mean, those guys work so hard. You should use the entire thing, shouldn't you? Not just in between a white line and a yellow line. You got the whole thing. That's why I like country roads. No white line or yellow line. You just enjoy it all. But I had this habit of walking like this. And then as a teenager, I got pretty to do about myself and thought that I needed to walk with a little bit of swag, right? And I walked that way. And then now as an adult, I walk completely different. I'm more purposeful in where I'm going because I got to get there. I got to take as little steps as possible to get there. I don't want to wear myself out, right? So walking is interesting. And today, the title of my message is Walk This Way. Pastor Josh thinks that I should sing a song and wear tights and have big, big hair. Is that the deal when I say this? Yeah, there's no... I second that emotion. No, you don't. You never return. But that's the title of my message. So if you can turn to 1 Thessalonians. Just a scarf. Just wear a scarf. Wow, I'm so distracted now. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Now, this letter was written by the Apostle Paul to the Thessalonican church. So they planted Paul, Silas, Timothy, and Luke planted this church. And Paul's thinking about it, thinking about them. Like, is this still healthy? I mean, we had to leave all of a sudden. Are they getting it? Are they living for Jesus? Or are they just bailed on him? What's going on? What's happening in their lives, right? And so we see this picture, And Paul sends Timothy because Timothy, he's Greek. And this was a Greek place. And so Paul couldn't go back, but Timothy could. So Timothy goes back. He goes, "How y'all doing?" And he checks in with them. And then he comes back to Paul and says, "Hey, they're doing great. Boy, they sure love Jesus and they love each other. They're doing amazing." And then as Timothy goes back to Paul, he's got, they have questions. And when I look at chapter 4, I see Paul answering two of their questions. One was, when's Jesus going to come back? And that will be next week. I'll give you the exact day and hour, but you'll have to come next week to hear it. That's not true. I won't. But it will be next week. And this week is like, so how do we live? How do we walk? How do we walk this out? And so he starts this chapter 4 with verse 1. It says this: "As for other matters," all this other stuff kind of changes the direction. "Brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God." Now, when we read this chapter and today this picture, in order to live to please God. See, this is the objective that he wants to come across. I want you to please God. And so I'm going to share what that looks like with you. But I need you to know the focal point, the focus is to please God. And again, remember, he's writing to these people that have come into relationship with Jesus, that are living for Jesus and wanting to live this out. And so this idea of pleasing God is deep in their hearts. It would be like a marriage. You know, I hate the dishes. I loathe the dishes. There, I would rather clean a toilet with my toothbrush and then use it. I would do that more than I want to do the dishes. You see that picture? Do you get this idea of that? The only reason I hate them, but I do them because I know that when I do them, first of all, my wife thinks that I'm very cute. Not when I do them because I have a bad attitude. But she appreciates it. She feels like I'm a part of the family when I do dishes, that I'm aiding in this part. But boy, can I tell you again? I hate the dishes. Just don't like them, but I still do them. Now, when we look at this picture of pleasing God, there are some things that we do that we may not like, but we do it because we want to please God. We're designed for Him. We're designed by Him for His pleasure. And so how we live, how we move, how we act is all for Him. Live in order to please God as if, in fact, you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. So we're not only encouraging you to please God, but we taught you, we shared with you how to do this. And we don't just urge you to do it a little bit, but we want you to do it more and more. We want you to walk in this way. Verse 3, it is God's will that you should be sanctified. Now, I'm going to stop right there, but we're going to come back to that word. So if I get distracted, remind me, hey, sanctified. Okay, good. We're on the same page, right? Are we? Okay. Eric, we're on the same page? Okay. Sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the pagans. Not passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God, and that in this matter no one should wrong or take advantage of his brother or sister. The Lord will punish all those who commit such sins, for God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. Therefore, anyone who rejects this instruction does not reject a human being, but God, the very God who gives you his Holy Spirit. Now about your love for one another. We do not need to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all of God's family throughout Macedonia. Yet we urge you, brothers and sisters, to do so more and more, and to make your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business. And every time I read that statement, MYOB was such a cool statement I said when I was a kid, but it doesn't sound very cool anymore. And work with your hands, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so that you will not be dependent on anyone. So when we look at this passage, we've got all kinds of stuff, and yes, we'll talk about the awkward stuff too, but before we get to the awkward stuff, the two objectives of these pieces of scripture is, one, to please God. The second one is to win the respect of outsiders. Is that interesting? So the two objectives are, one, to please God, and the second one, to win the respect of outsiders. So what's amazing is it lays it out how to do this. The first one, back to sanctification. Sanctification. Should I go through the guitar? Oh, no. I'm getting looks. Boy, I tell you what. Sanctification. Now, this is a super big, fancy word. It means to set apart. That's what it means, to set apart, right? So when we look at this word, set apart, sanctify, it's also the word where we get the word from that root or root, if you're from Yakima like me, is where you get that word. The root is same as where we get the word holy, which also means to set apart, sanctify. Oh, it's also where we get the word saint. Okay, so I want you all to say saint real quick. Now I want you to say set apart. So it's very specific in what you're set apart for. To sanctify means to set apart for God. Are you following me? So when we look at, boy, you're going to have a deal. Okay. So when we look at this idea, where is Zach? Okay, come here, Zach. Set apart to be holy, to be sanctified, to be a saint. So when I come into relationship with Jesus, or say Zach came into relationship with Jesus, can you see that, those arrows? Probably not, huh? Okay. So Zach, when Zach, this is Zach, everybody say, hey, Zach.
Hey, Zach.
We're exactly the same height. I have more hair, but that's another story. Thanks for bending down for me. I appreciate that. Okay, so stand on that arrow. Okay, so when Zach began a relationship with Jesus, all of a sudden, he trusted his life with Jesus, and all of a sudden, what God does is he sanctified him. Position. Everybody say position. So all of a sudden, he's a saint based off of his, what was that word again? But the other word, the P word? Position. So say position again. Position. So he's a saint. He's in relationship with Jesus. Oh, this is so amazing to me because it's by his position. Did he earn it? Did he achieve it? No, it was a position thing. It was a position thing. I remember in high school. So in high school, I struggled with school, not because I wasn't smart enough, not because I didn't work hard. I did work hard, but because I didn't always show up to class and I didn't do the work. I worked hard at not doing the work, right? But then I go into this class and one of these teachers, the first day of class, one of these teachers comes in and she says, or he says, I can't remember who it is. I just can remember the statement because it was so flooring to me. She looks at every student and says, you have an A. And I'm like, what? I have an A? This is so awesome. I usually get an A in PE. But this is not PE. How am I getting an A? This is the first day of class. I didn't do anything to get it. I just came to the class. I just walked into the door. And all of a sudden, this lady's giving me A's. I'm like, yeah, I got an A. Woo-hoo. I'm so excited. I have an A. And then the statement comes. Now y'all just got to keep it. You mean, how do you keep it? You keep it by showing up to class and like, oh. You keep it by doing the assignments. Oh. You keep it by working hard and studying for the test. Oh, but I have it? I have an A? I remember very vividly going home and saying, Mom, I've got an A! Yes! She's so excited for me. So when we come into relationship with Jesus, it all of a sudden, by position, what's that word again? Position. I'm sanctified. I'm set apart. Set apart. Now, who am I set apart for? God, right? I'm set apart for Jesus. That's where I'm at. Are you following me? So when we see that word sanctified, we go, okay, so I'm by position, I'm set apart. But not only is it positional, but there's a second part to it. The second part, to this is progressive. Everybody say progressive. So what does that mean? That means that I am moving. Yeah, just pretend like you're moonwalking or something. Can you moonwalk? What? Yeah. Okay. So, but we want to do. Okay, that was awesome. I didn't even know he knew what moonwalking was. How did you know that? You're 20. Okay. Positional, right? And progressive. That means that I am working toward. And in order to move forward, it's crazy. But you actually need to, what do you need to do, you think? Move forward. It's progressive. So he's saved, he's being saved, and he'll be saved. Or another way to say that is he's set apart, he's set aparting, and he will be set apart. Sanctification, right? So not only is he by position, knows who he is, he's sanctified, he's a saint by position. He's a saint by position. So when I come into relationship with Jesus, I'm a saint by position. When you come into relationship with Jesus, you're a saint by position. What's that mean? That I'm set apart to please God. So if this is saint, then the truth is, this is not. So anything over here in this side, this is pleasing to God. Anything over here on this side, this is evil. This is not pleasing to God. See, God's people, when they come into relationship with him, they're saints. All of God's people. And they're progressively moving towards who again? God. And what is that again? To please him, right? So Zach, in his relationship with Jesus, all that he is, all that he says, not just from the inward aspect, but the outward aspect. I'm going to put my desk back over here on my table. But all that he is exists to please God. Now, Romans 12:2, it says this. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. It says, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Actually, it's Romans 12:1 is good too, but I'll just do 2 from memory, right? Do not conform to the pattern of this world. So what it's saying is that when you're in this position, when you're a saint, when you began a relationship with Jesus, don't think like you used to. Don't live like you used to. Don't be controlled by the things that you used to be controlled by. But be transformed by, isn't he so gracious? I'm throwing him around and pushing him around. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So what that's saying is that as I am progressive, so again, what was sanctification? It's positional, it's progressive. And then there's a third aspect to sanctification. It's perfect. Perfect.
Well, ain't nobody perfect.
You're right, nobody's perfect. But sanctification, again, position, progress, perfection. So this doesn't happen. This happens. Oh, man, this happens. Let me tell you when this happens. There's a day or a time when you or I pass away, when we die. And we've had perfect sanctification. We're in his presence. All this stuff is behind. Because the truth is that even as you are progressing in your sanctification, you still have the tendency to want to do this over here. Do not conform. Why would I have to even say that? Because the tendency is to come back over here. But it's progressive, so that means that I continue on.
And then someday, either when Jesus returns, by the way, I don't know if you get this impression or have this impression, ain't long now. And we'll talk more about that next Sunday. But this Sunday, this progression will end up someday in perfection. I can't believe I didn't see that mic on the other side of Zach. He's so skinny. Okay, come on. So when we see this and see this idea, let's get back to the word. Thessalonians. It is God's will that you should be sanctified. So God desires, that's his design for you, is to be conformed. Again, it says it in Romans as well. It's that we're to be conformed to his son, Jesus Christ. So in this, I'm put by position, I'm a saint. By progression, I'm being made more like Jesus, conformed more like him. Wait, what does that mean? That means that there's something internal that happens within me, that he changes me, that he makes me new, that he conforms me to his image. The way I used to think is not the way I think now. If you're a believer, can you picture some of the things that you used to think that you don't think now? That are different. And so what's interesting about this piece of scripture is after the sanctify, that you should avoid sexual immorality. That's something that I think differently about now than I did then. To be honest with you. I mean, when we look at that sexual immorality, let's just, we'll drop everything. I'll go deeper what that means and what that is. But let's just talk about sex. Exciting, isn't it? So I thought it was exciting. Okay, so sex, I think differently. And the truth is there are three ways to think about it. One is more like a duty regulation type of thing, right? So sex is for one thing, make babies. That's it. In fact, what's interesting is that throughout history, we've seen that picture that sex was bad, that it was evil, that it's only to make babies, only to procreate, not anything else. Why? That's a good question, the why, right? That maybe that's me. Is it more than that? Could it be more than that? I would argue that yes. It's more than just making babies. It's nice. It's good. It should be done within the proper context. Now, the second way to look at it is appetite. And this is the way I used to look at it. I remember one vivid moment at Starbucks after I became a believer, and I was working at Starbucks. I was working full-time at Starbucks, and this is how I supported my wife and I. I just remember having a conversation with somebody. I don't know why sex and coffee go together, but we talked about, she brought it up and is like, yeah, it's just an appetite thing. We're all animals. We're done. We're made to live this way and just do it. There's no regulation. There's no boundaries. It's who I am. That's an interesting concept. But I've found from living in that idea or mentality is that my body's in charge. Tells me what to do. I'm not in charge. And what's interesting about it is that when it's that way, all this baggage is claimed. And even more than all this baggage is claimed that I have to carry, the truth is that you'll carry that for the rest of your life. And you fight those battles in your mind over and over and over again. The third way is a countercultural relationship. Currently, a counterculture relationship means that it's a relationship. And my first and foremost emphasis, I'm sorry, I forgot you're still up here, is to progress towards God. Right? So when I come into relationship with Jesus, all of a sudden I positioned my life as a saint. And I am to progress towards Jesus. And as this reflects, the truth is, you can have a seat. This is a really awkward time to have you standing up here. Go ahead, have a seat. Good job. That's a partial clap. I like that. I'll probably call you back up, so be ready. So this idea, the three ways, again, I could, you know, it's just for a single purpose. It's a duty. It's a regulation, but no why. And in that sense, the rules are in charge, right? I don't do this, I do this. I don't do this, I do this. I don't do this, I do this. I do this, I do this, right? And the other one, when it's appetite, it's my body's in charge. And when it's the counterculture relationship, all of a sudden, what's internal and external is both and. It starts with internal and is expressed externally. In this position, Jesus is in charge. And that means that it is blessed, it's good. In his context, what he decides is good. So now let's look at that again. That you should avoid sexual immorality. Now that word avoid, that's kind of nice. I mean, because here's, when I look at it, there's sexual immorality. So when I look at that, I just go, oh, well, I'm just going to avoid. Keep going. Yeah, you know, that makes sense. I just go around. But that avoid is not even the right word. And so when we look at that word avoid, in other versions, it says to abstain from sexual immorality. So what that means is that it's to clean out, remove, have nothing to do with. Now, when we look at sexual immorality, who decides what that is? How does that look, right? When I was over here, I decided, my body decided. Or maybe my rules decided. When I'm over here, God decides. But what if my opinion differs? Oh, it can, but God decides. And so the problem is that we walk in this tension. Right? We want what I think is right, what I want is true. But again, back to that word sanctification. I'm progressively being made. I'm progressively being set apart for what pleases him, his good and perfect and pleasing will. So when we look at this, so that abstain is even bigger than anything that we could really clean out, remove, have nothing to do with. Now, sexual immorality, we look at that word and we go, oh, what is it? What does it mean? Sexual immorality, that word is porneia. Pornea is where we get the word pornography. So if I'm living to please God, what that means is that I am looking to please Him in every area of my life. And when it comes to this instance, it's even greater than that. This word pornea. Did you know that this year it's projected that $50 billion will be spent on pornography alone? The NFL. I mean, those guys, they make tons of money, right? 15 million. Why would Scripture say sanctification, 1:5 versus 5:0? Oh, excuse me, not million, billion. My bad. Billion, big difference. 50 billion versus 15 billion. Still a lot of money, right? Okay. So we see this picture of why it's a prominent thing. So what is sexual immorality? It's anything that's outside of being set apart towards God. So that would mean just like sleeping with other people outside of marriage. And now when I say marriage, I need you to be very clear on what I mean by marriage, because that definition has changed. We sometimes think, well, marriage is marriage. It doesn't matter between who and who. It does matter. And the reason why it matters is because the foundation of marriage was set in Genesis when God took a man and God took a woman and He put them together as one. And He put them together because God does this as part of who He is. He creates life from. He always creates life. That's who He is. When I come into relationship with Him, the Bible says that He gives me a new life. I have a new way of thinking. I'm a new creation. Wow. He's about life. He always is, always has been, always will be. It's consistent as consistent can be. God is about life. So He put man and a woman together. So when we look at this, we say, okay, so sex outside of that context is over here. Well, yeah, okay, I get that. Okay, I can do that. And then it even goes deeper. It says that if I have sex outside of marriage or even before marriage with someone else, you're doing the wrong thing again if you read it. Because the Bible says to be honorable and holy even to others. Don't lead others astray. Sexual immorality. Now, when we look at this idea in this picture, it's even deeper than just what I do. It's more than my actions. Because God cares more about us more than just our actions. He cares about our character. In fact, Jesus confronted this. If you hate anybody in your heart, you've committed murder. Wait. He brings it deeper. He takes your thought life in with it. If you lust after another person, you've committed adultery. It's deeper. So when we look at that word and sexual immorality, it's huge, it's broad, it's big, but the one that decides what it is not me. In fact, he says it, and Paul says it in the scripture. He says, you're not doing this, I don't share this because this is from a human perspective. This is to please God. This is from God. You honor God in this. It ain't no preacher. It ain't no teacher. It's God that you honor. And so if I come into relationship with Jesus, all of a sudden, I'm in position to be sanctified. I'm a saint. My thoughts, my will, my body, my actions, all that I am are set apart. Why? To please him. And so I'm progressively making my way forward. And so I live differently. I speak differently. My character and my conduct matter. That's what he's saying. And what's interesting is the culture that they're in. It was a sexualized culture. It was highly sexualized. It was everywhere. And there were no boundaries, no morality towards it. It's like whoever, whenever, your body's in charge. It's an appetite. And so when we look at this piece of scripture, we go, okay, well, no, it's different. It's not an appetite. It's pleasing to God in God's context. Outside of that, it's not. Now, here's the difficulty in all of this. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The difficulty is that when we walk in life, we are consistently consistent about something. The line. Everybody sees the line. You see the line, right? I talked about how I drive, and I like to use the whole road, and that means that I cross the line. And so when we decide to not be in charge of our body, so this picture of sanctification is not only that we're in charge of what we say, what we do, how we do it, but the difference between Jesus and being over here and just doing it like, oh, this is just for you know, tradition's sake or duty or regulation type of things. I just need to have babies, you know, whatever. So the difference between, I lost my focus. It's weird. The difference between this and this is surrender. But that's not where I was going. I'm sorry. That line, we have this tendency to focus in on that line. And when we focus in on that line, we have this tendency to straddle it. Right? What's interesting, if pornography really is a $50 billion business, that means that every single person in this room is affected by it. And the danger in it, if some of us in this room are saints, we're set apart, sanctified, right? That means that we're progressing towards Jesus by position, progression, with the hope of someday seeing him in person. So we have two options. We can focus in on him, or we can focus in on the line. We can look at the line and continue to straddle the line. What happens, and I think this is true, is that we stop living on the other side of the line. So when we look at stuff like, just to be clear, pornography is more than just images. It could be thoughts that we entertain. Wow. I wish my husband was like that. And then we entertain that thought. Now, what's interesting about pornography specifically is it does a chemical reaction within our brain that does something in our brain. It reshapes our brain, neuroplasticity. So if these lines were connecting, there's little shoots of energy coming back and forth.
what happens is that when pornography is involved, what happens is it reshapes it, and there's a new line. And how that affects us as a whole is that, in a lot of ways, but one of them is researchers have shown that even 17-year-olds have ED because of that neuroplasticity, because what is fantasy and what is reality doesn't match up. And so God's perfect and pleasing will is for us to be set apart in everything. So that means that we're supposed to live over here. But oftentimes we get so caught up in that line, we just get that, we see that image and we just entertain that thought. And that thought takes us captive. Scripture says to take every thought captive and put it under the submission of Jesus Christ. Zach, can you come again? But you need to run. To take every thought captive and put it under the submission of Jesus Christ. You're not running. Okay, so what that means is that Zach is a thought. Then I'm to put it under submission. I had to get up here because he's so tall. But I'm to put it under submission of who? Jesus Christ, right? And see, what happens is that if I let that thought take me captive, what happens is I live on the line. And as I let that thought take me captive, what happens, the truth is, I live so far on the other side of the line that becomes my norm. It becomes my focus. And quite frankly, it becomes my addiction. Is it interesting that the scripture says to control your body? That says to control. That means that I'm in charge. But here's the amazing thing, is not only am I in charge, but I have the Holy Spirit to empower me to do it. So all of a sudden, I the Holy Spirit's in me and living in me. And all of a sudden, that I don't have to be owned or focused by the line. I can live for him everywhere and every day. And I strive to live, since I'm empowered, I can turn from that. I can find freedom from that. I don't have to live straddling the line and thinking about this side over here. Are you following me? Because I'm a saint. I'm not who I was. That doesn't dictate who I am. I found freedom in Christ, and I continue to progress towards him. And I continue to live for him. Because when it says to control your body, God doesn't just go, okay, do it on your own. It's not a bunch of duties or regulations. It's not who I am. It's not my rights. It's not an appetite. But it's counterculture relationship. He empowers me to do this with him. Go ahead and lay on the ground. There you go. I was going to trip him, but I decided not to. Not a good idea. He's really tall. But this idea, right, that even when I fall, even when I fail, where do I fail towards?
to God.
Okay, get back up, Zach.
Oh, I should help you. And then the power of the Holy Spirit helps me and aids me to progress me to move forward. So when we see this piece of scripture and we see this relationship, God calls us to walk this way. Live in a way, positionally, I'm a saint. Progressively, I'm a saint. Perfectly, eventually, I'll be a saint. So how do we deal with all of this other stuff? We take every thought captive and put it under the submission of Jesus Christ. What that means is that if I don't have something to exchange it with, prepared, when it comes, I'm going to dwell on it. But if I have something to exchange it with, I'm going to dwell on him. You follow me? Exchange the truth for the lie. The lie is this will satisfy me. This will fulfill me. This is who I am. This is how I was designed. This is the lie. No, the truth is I am called. I am a saint. I am gifted. I am for his good, perfect, and pleasing will. I am a new creation. That old is gone. The new has come. It has no authority over me, has no power over me, but Jesus Christ himself, who empowers me to live for him, who sanctified me, who calls me, who leads me, who directs me, who gifts me, who empowers me to walk for him, he is who I am. And so I strive towards him and all that he is. And then when I fail, I fail towards him. I fall towards him. That means that I ask him to forgive me. I ask him to make me new. I ask for him to change me. Zach, you can sit down again. Are you going to sit in the front row? Okay. He is my focal point. So still doesn't seem to go, okay, so what do we do if we're in that? What do we do if we're at that point where we're owned by living outside, we're straddling the line and we find ourselves living on the other side? What do we do with that? This is how we always do it when it comes to God. We tell him we're sorry. We ask him to empower us to live for him and to honor him. You know what he does? Is he forgives us. He makes us whole again. And you know what? He doesn't just do that, but he empowers us to do it.
Well, Pastor, I've done that. I tell God I'm sorry every time. In fact, I go approach it and I go, oh, God will forgive me. That's not repentance. Pleasing God means I'm sorry, God. I won't do it again. I just don't feel like I'm healed. Scripture says that if you want healing, it says confess your sins one to another. That they may pray for you, that they may carry your burdens with you, and that you may be James. That's the scripture that says that. It's in James. So you confess. Something about us hates confessing. But there's nothing more freeing or healing than confessing. Would you just take a moment? We're not going to end with the song. I'm just going to pray, and then we're going to end. Is that okay with you today? Does it feel intense to you? Feel like I'm glistening. No. Let's pray. Would you just take a moment to bow your heads? Let me ask you a question or a couple questions before we pray. Is this something that you are struggling with, that you need healing from, that you find yourself on the line or the other side of the line, and you've been on the other side of the line for so long that you don't know which end is up? Is that you? That's you. I'm going to pray for you right now. Ready? Father God, I ask that you bring healing. You bring freedom from this addiction. I believe by faith that you'll do it and that you'll clean it out. So I ask this in Jesus' name. Father, I pray that you would help us to be positioned towards you, progressing towards you. And God, when we fail, when we sin, that our response would be repentance to you, telling you we're sorry, striving for you. God, I thank you so much for every single person that's here and also connecting online. Pray that you would speak to our hearts and that you would draw us closer to you. Lord Jesus, if we have a past that continues to come up to our minds, I pray that you would give us freedom from it. That you'd help us to focus in on you instead of our past. That you help us to walk in forgiveness instead of our past. That you help us to progress and remind us of the position that we're in. We claim you. We're saints. Have your way in us and through us. If you're here this morning and you want to trust Jesus with your life, would you just take a moment and say, Jesus, I trust you with my life. Be the leader of my life. Set me apart for your benefit. May I please you in all that I do and all that I say. In Jesus' name. God, I also ask one more thing. I know we're almost done, but just one more thing. God, may we not only please you, but may we be a people that earn the right to be heard from outsiders. God, help us to be more like you, loving and gracious and kind, attentive, carrying one another's burdens, servants, who look to point people to you. May our lives be an action that demonstrates you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Would you stand up? Bless you guys. You're dismissed.